Students, today we are going to study the topic larynx. It is organ of respiration and phonation. It protects the lower respiratory passage as it acts as a watchdog. It prevents the entry of any foreign body other than the ear. It extends from the upper border of epiglottis to the lower border of cricoid cartilage. Here in this diagram, this is sagittal section of head neck. Here we can see this is the epiglottis and this is the upper border. So it extends from the upper border of epiglottis to the lower border of the cricoid cartilage. This one. This is lower border of cricoid cartilage. Now its location, it lies opposite to the C3 to C6 vertebra. In case of children, it is slightly at higher level. Now, measurements. Its vertical length is 44 mm in case of male and 36 mm in case of female. And transverse measurements are 43 mm in male and 41 mm in female. Now, structure of the larynx. Larynx is made up of cartilages, membranes, intrinsic extrinsic muscles, and mucosal lining is there. So these are the components of larynx: cartilages, membranes, ligaments, intrinsic and extrinsic muscles, and mucosal lining of the larynx. So here in this diagram, you can see these are the cartilages. This one, this is membrane. These are the muscles. Now, what are the cartilages of larynx? Larynx consists of total 9 cartilages. Some are paired, some are unpaired. So, single cartilage or unpaired cartilages are thyroid cartilage. Here you can see this largest shield-like cartilage, this one. This is the thyroid cartilage. Then, cricoid cartilage, this one. This is cricoid cartilage. And epiglottis, this one. The epiglottis. In this diagram, you can see this is the epiglottis. There are some paired cartilages. These are arytenoid cartilage, corniculate, and cuneiform. This is posterior view of the larynx. In this, you can see this is arytenoid cartilage. This one. This is corniculate cartilage. In this diagram, also you can see this is corniculate and this is cuneiform. Small elevations you can see here. These are because of the corniculate and cuneiform cartilages. So total cartilages are 9 cartilages. 3 are unpaired, that is thyroid, cricoid, and epiglottis, and 3 are paired, that is arytenoid, corniculate, and cuneiform. These 3 cartilages are paired cartilages. All the cartilages of larynx, they are haline in nature, except the epiglottis, corniculate, cuneiform, apex of arytenoid cartilage, and tip of the vocal process of arytenoid cartilage. So these epiglottis, corniculate, cuneiform, apex of arytenoid, tip of vocal process, these are elastic in nature. So age-related changes does not take place in this cartilage. Now shape of these cartilages. Epiglottis, let's see here, this is the epiglottis. It is leaf shape. Thyroid cartilage, you can see this is thyroid cartilage. It is shield like, it protects the larynx from front. Then cricoid cartilage, this is signet ring shaped cartilage. Then corniculate is horn shape, cuneiform is wedge shape, and arytenoid is pyramidal in shape. Now, first we will see thyroid cartilage. It is largest cartilage of larynx. And it is, you know, haline in nature. It is shield-like or shield-shaped. It protects the larynx from anteside. It has 2 thyroid laminae. You can see in this diagram, these are the thyroid laminae, which are quadrilateral in shape. So each lamina has upper border. This is the upper border. Then lower border. This one is lower border. Then anterior border. Then this is posterior border. And 2 surfaces. outer surface and the inner surface. So this thyroid lamina, they meet anteriorly in front at the thyroid angle. This thyroid angle is more prominent in case of male, also called as an Adam's apple. You can feel this anteriorly in the midline. This one. And this thyroid angle is 90 degree in case of male and it is 120 degree in case of female. So it is acute in case of male. First we will see upper border of this thyroid cartilage. This is upper border of thyroid cartilage, this one. See, this upper border is convex or concave and it gives attachment to one membrane, that is thyroid membrane. This is the upper border and this membrane which is going to attach the upper border of thyroid cartilage with the hyoid bone. This membrane is the thyroid membrane. Now lower border, this is the lower border of the thyroid cartilage. You can see in the anterior part this border is almost straight, in the posterior part it is concave. So this anterior part of this border is connected to the cricoid cartilage. This is cricoid cartilage and this is arch of the cricoid cartilage. So anterior part of this border is connected to arch of cricoid cartilage by a fibroelastic membrane, that is the conus elasticus. And rest of the border provide insertion to one muscle, that is cricothyroid muscle. Now two borders are there. This is anterior border and posterior border. So total four borders are there: upper, lower border, anterior and posterior border. We have seen upper and lower border. Now anterior border. This is the anterior border. Anterior border of both the lamina meet at the thyroid angle. We have seen posterior border. This is the posterior border. Thyroid cartilage. This posterior border, it extends above and below to form horn or cornua. So above this extension, you can see this is the superior cornua or superior horn, and this is the inferior cornua or inferior horn. This inferior horn, it articulates with the cricoid cartilage. It articulates with the cricoid cartilage and forms synovial joint, that is the cricothyroid joint. Posterior border. This posterior border receives conjoint insertion of three muscles. These are from above downward, palatopharyngeus, then sylpingopharyngeus and stylopharyngeus. Now two surfaces are there, outer surface and inner surface. This, in this diagram you can see this is outer surface. On outer surface there is an oblique line. This oblique line gives attachment to some muscles. These are the thyroid muscle, then sternothyroid muscle, and inferior constrictor part of the pharynx. This inferior constrictor part of pharynx is nothing but the thyropharyngeus part of the inferior constrictor. Now, posterior surface of the thyroid angle. We have seen thyroid angle, which is formed by meeting of the two thyroid lamina in front. So, this posterior surface of this thyroid angle, it gives attachment to some structure. From above downward, these structures are the thyroepiglottic ligament. Then below it, you see there is attachment of a pair of vestibular ligaments. And below the vestibular ligament, there is attachment of pair of vocal ligament. So from above downward, attachment of structure at the posterior surface of thyroid lamina, thyroid angle are thyroepiglottic ligament, then pair of vestibular ligament and pair of vocal ligament. Now, on each side of the vocal ligament, there is attachment of three muscles. Medial to laterally, these muscles are attached. These muscles are vocalis, then thyroarytenoid, this one, and thyroepiglotticus. So on each side of this vocal ligament, there is attachment of the muscles. Next cartilage is the cricoid cartilage. Cricoid cartilage is signet ring-shaped cartilage. It is situated at the level of C6 vertebra. It lies below the thyroid cartilage. You can see this is thyroid cartilage and this is the cricoid cartilage. Then it has two parts. That is the anterior arch. This one is anterior arch and this is the posterior lamina. So this posterior lamina is almost quadrilateral in shape, upper lower border, anterior and posterior surface. And this anterior arch has upper lower border and outer inner surface. This is the upper border, which has inner and outer ring. And this is the posterior lamina. This one. Now, this is the upper border of posterior lamina. This upper border articulates with the base of arytenoid cartilage and forms one joint. This is the cricoarytenoid joint. It is synovial arytenoid joint, and rotatory as well as gliding movements are possible at this joint. Lower border of the posterior lamina, it articulates with the trochea. So it articulates below the trochea by the it gives attachment to trochealis muscle. This posterior lamina has anterior and the posterior surface, anterior surface, it is lined with the mucosal lining of the laryngeal cavity, and posterior surface, it shows a median ridge. On each side of the median ridge, there is depressed area, and that depressed area gives attachment to muscle, intrinsic muscle of the larynx. So you see later on, that is the posterior cricoarytenoid muscle. Anterior arch, this is upper border of the anterior arch. You can see this anterior arch is sloping downward and forward, and this is the upper border, this is the lower border. This upper border has inner lip, outer lip. Inner lip of the this anterior arch gives attachment to one membrane, that is the conus elasticus. Here you can see a cricovocal membrane, and one fibrous band is there, that is the conus elasticus. Cricovocal membrane is continuous with this conus elasticus. So upper border of this inner lip of the upper border of the anterior arch gives attachment to cricovocal membrane, which is continuous later on with this conus elasticus. This is cricovocal membrane and this is conus elasticus. Lower border of this anterior arch, it is attached to first cartilaginous segment of the trochea by tricotracheal membrane. This is first cartilaginous ring. So this lower border is attached to first cartilaginous ring by the tricotracheal membrane. Now this is the outer surface of the anterior arch. Outer surface of anterior arch, it gives origin to one intrinsic muscle of the larynx, that is cricothyroid. We will see later on in detail about that. Just remember, in this outer surface, it gives attachment to cricothyroid muscle. See, this inferior horn of the thyroid cartilage, it articulates with the cricoid cartilage, side of the cricoid cartilage. Here when synovial joint is formed, cricothyroid joint. This is also, it permits the gliding as well as rotatory movements. So two joints here form, that is the cricothyroid joint and cricoarytenoid joint. Both are synovial variety and they permit gliding as well as rotatory movements. So this cricoid cartilage is complete ring shape, signet ring shape. It forms foundation stone of the larynx. Now arytenoid cartilage. This is arytenoid cartilage. This one, and this is pyramidal in shape. It has apex and base. You can see in this diagram. This is the apex and this is the base of arytenoid cartilage. There are three surfaces: medial surface, posterior surface, and the anterolateral surface. And two processes are there: vocal process and muscular process. You can see this is the vocal process, and this is the muscular process. This one. This is the base which gives attachment to the upper border of posterior lamina of the cricoid cartilage, and the joint form is cricoarytenoid joint. Apex, it articulates with the corniculate cartilage. This is also synovial variety of joint. First, we will see vocal process. Vocal process, you can see this is the vocal process. It projects forward, this one. It projects forward and it gives attachment to vocal ligament. This is vocal ligament. So this vocal ligament is attached from the posterior surface of thyroid angle up to the tip of vocal process. And vocalis muscle, It is attached to vocal process just lateral to the vocal ligament. Muscular process. This is the muscular process. This muscular process, it projects laterally backward and it gives insertion to intrinsic muscles of the larynx. In front, that is the lateral cricoarytenoid, and posteriorly it gives attachment to the posterior cricoarytenoid. So on the muscular process, there is attachment of the intrinsic muscles of larynx anteriorly as well as posteriorly. Now next cartilage is epiglottis. Epiglottis is leaf shaped cartilage. You can see in this diagram, this one, this is the epiglottis. Here, this is the epiglottis. This is posterior view of the larynx. Here you can see complete leaf shaped cartilage. This is the epiglottis. This epiglottis is situated behind the base of tongue and the hyoid bone. This is the hyoid bone. So it is situated behind the base of tongue and hyoid bone. There are two surfaces, anterior surface and the posterior surface. Here in this diagram you can see the posterior surface. Anterior surface, it is connected in the upper part with the base of the tongue by a median and pair of lateral glossal epiglottic fold. Here in this diagram you can see this is the median glossal epiglottic and this is the pair of lateral glossal epiglottic fold. So in the upper part, the anterior surface is connected with the base of tongue by this median and pair of lateral glossal epiglottic fold. In between these two folds, you can see a depressed area. This is the valicula, this one. Now, lower part of the anterior surface, lower part of the anterior surface is connected in front with the hyoid bone. This one. And it is connected with the hyoid bone with one ligament, that is the hyoepiglottic ligament. So, ligament connecting the epiglottis with the hyoid bone. This is the hyoepiglottic ligament. Posterior surface. This is the posterior surface of the epiglottis. Here, this is posterior surface. So, this posterior surface, it forms the anterior wall of the upper part of laryngeal cavity. And the lower part, this posterior surface, it shows one tubercle. Lower end and upper end. This is upper end. This upper end is free. This one. And it forms boundary of the laryngeal inlet. And lower end, this one is the lower end. This lower end is connected to the posterior surface of the thyroid angle by ligament, that is the thyroepiglottic ligament. This one, this is the thyroid cartilage. This one. So lower end is connected to the posterior surface of thyroid angle by thyroepiglottic ligament. So this epiglottis has two ends, upper end, lower end. It has two surfaces, anterior surface, this one, and posterior surface, this one, which is towards the laryngeal cavity, right? And it has two lateral border, which gives attachment to aryepiglottic fold. So laterally here, these are the lateral border, which gives attachment to aryepiglottic fold. Now corniculate and cuneiform cartilages. These corniculate and cuneiform cartilages are small nodule-like cartilages. They are situated within the aryepiglottic fold. In this diagram, you can see this is the aryepiglottic fold, and in this aryepiglottic fold, small elevations you can see. These are the corniculate and the cuneiform cartilages. They are situated at right angle to each other. This corniculate cartilage, it articulates below with the apex of the arytenoid cartilage. So articulate with the apex of arytenoid cartilage, and they keep the aryepiglottic fold upright. So whenever the food is passing through piriform fossa, it is prevented to enter into the laryngeal cavity. This upright aryepiglottic fold. So it gives support to the aryepiglottic fold and keep the aryepiglottic fold upright. Now, membranes and ligaments of the larynx. There is a thyrohyoid membrane we have seen between the upper border of thyroid cartilage and the hyoid bone. This is body of hyoid and this is cornua, the cornua of the hyoid bone. So between the hyoid bone and the upper border of thyroid cartilage, one membrane we have seen, this is thyrohyoid membrane. The median plane, this thyrohyoid membrane, is thickened from medium thyroid ligament, and laterally this thyroid membrane is thickened from lateral thyroid ligament, which is connecting the this greater coronohyoid bone with the superior corona of the thyroid cartilage. So this one, this is lateral thyroid ligament, and this is the median thyroid ligament, and this whole membrane is the thyroid membrane. So this membrane is just thicker in the median plane to form median thyroid ligament, and laterally thicker to form lateral thyroid. Then median cricothyroid ligament, this is thyroid cartilage lower border, this is cricoid cartilage. In the median plane, one ligament is there which is connecting these two structure. This is the median cricothyroid ligament, this one. Then there is a quadrate ligament, quadrate membrane, then cricovocal membrane is there, cricotracheal membrane is there, hyoepiglottic ligament and thyroepiglottic ligament. We have seen hyoepiglottic and thyroepiglottic ligament, which are connecting the epiglottis with the hyoid bone and thyroid cartilage respectively. We are going to see in detail about the quadrate membrane and the cricovocal membrane later. Cricotracheal membrane, it is connecting the lower border of the cricoid cartilage and the arch of the cricoid cartilage with the first cartilage in this ring of the trachea, this one. So these two structures are connected by this cricotracheal membrane, this one. So here there is a cricotracheal. Quadrate membrane, it extends between the epiglottis. This is epiglottis, this bluish colored cartilage you can see here, this epiglottis. So between epiglottis and the arytenoid cartilage, this is arytenoid cartilage, and this is the sagittal section of the larynx. Here you can see this epiglottis and this arytenoid cartilage. Between these two you can see one membrane, this is the quadrate membrane. So this quadrate membrane, upper border of the quadrate membrane, it lies in the arytenoid fold. This is the arytenoid fold. And lower border of the quadrate membrane is thickened here. It is thickened to form the vestibular ligament. This vestibular ligament, anteriorly it is attached to posterior surface of thyroid angle, and posteriorly it is attached to the anterolateral surface of the thyroid, anterolateral surface of the arytenoid cartilage. This vestibular ligament is covered with a fold of mucous membrane and forms the vestibular fold. Now next membrane is cricovocal membrane. Cricovocal membrane, it extends upward and medially. Here you can see this is cricovocal membrane. It extends upward and medially from the upper border of cricoid cartilage. This is cricoid cartilage, upper border of cricoid cartilage, anti-arch of the cricoid cartilage. It gives attachment to this cricovocal membrane. So it extends upward and medially, and it is continuous in front with this bonus elasticus. Upper free margin of the cricovocal membrane is thickened to form vocal ligament. So this vocal ligament, anteriorly it is attached to posterior surface of thyroid angle, and posteriorly it is attached to the tip of vocal process. So whole this ligament is the vocal ligament. So vocal ligament is formed by the thickening of upper free margin of cricovocal membrane, this one. Laterally, this vocal process gives attachment to one muscle, vocalis muscle. So this vocal ligament and vocalis muscle both are covered with fold of mucous membrane, forming the vocal fold. Vocal fold containing the vocal ligament and vocalis muscle, covered with mucous membrane. Vocal fold is also called as a mucous cord. In this diagram also you can see. Laryngeal cavity. This laryngeal cavity extends from the laryngeal inlet here. It extends from the laryngeal inlet to the lower border of cricoid cartilage. This is lower border of cricoid cartilage. It extends from the laryngeal inlet to the lower border of cricoid cartilage. And in the interior of laryngeal cavity, from above downward, you can see there are three folds. First is the arypiglottic fold. This is the arypiglottic fold, this one. Below it, you can see one fold. This is the vestibular fold, this one, and below the vestibular fold, this is the vocal fold. Okay. So In the interior, three folds are there: eriepiglottic fold, vestibular fold, and the Rupert fold. Now, space between the eriepiglottic fold, the space is called as a laryngeal inlet. The space between the vestibular fold, this is the vestibular fold. So, space between these two vestibular fold is called as a rima vestibuli. The space between the vocal fold is called rima glottalis. First, we will see laryngeal inlet. What are the boundaries of laryngeal inlet? This laryngeal inlet is bounded above and in front. Above and in front by the upper margin of the epiglottis. This one, leaf shaped cartilage, you can see this is epiglottis. So, it is bounded above and in front by this upper margin of the epiglottis. Then, it is bounded behind and below by interarytenoid fold of mucous membrane. Be the interarytenoid fold of mucous membrane, and on each side it is bounded by the eriepiglottic fold. So this is the eriepiglottic fold, you can see, and in this eriepiglottic fold, small elevations, you can see, these are the corniculate and cuneiform cartilage. So here you can see, this is the laryngeal inlet, this is epiglottis, this is eriepiglottic fold, and here will be the interarytenoid fold of mucous membrane. Is the laryngeal inlet. This eriepiglottic fold, it contains two cartilages, it contains two muscles and one membrane. So, it contains two muscles, that is the thyroepiglotticus and eriepiglotticus. It contains two cartilages, that is corniculate and cuneiform, and it contains upper margin of the quadrate membrane. So, these are the contents of the eriepiglottic fold. Now first we'll see this rima vestibula. We have seen rima vestibula is the space between the two vestibular fold. And this space is called rima vestibula. This rima vestibula acts as exit wall. It permits the air entry in inspiration and prevents the air exit in the expiration. Holding of breath at the end of inspiration is done by the opposition of the vestibular fold. This is important to increase the intrathoracic intra-abdominal pressure. During the act of micturition, defecation, parturition. Now, rima glottalis. We have seen this rima glottalis is a space between the two vocal folds. Here in this diagram, you can see this is vestibular fold and this is the vocal fold. So, space between these two vocal fold is the rima glottalis. This is a diameter is about 24 mm in case of male and 16 mm in case of the female. Boundaries, it is bounded in front by the thyroid angle, posterior surface of the thyroid angle. And posteriorly or behind it is bounded by interarytenoid mucous fold. And on each side it is bounded by the vocal fold in the anterior 3/4 portion and vocal process of arytenoid cartilage in the posterior 2/5 portion. So, vocal fold in the anterior 3/4 portion, this part form is also called membranous part of this vocal membranous part of the rima glottalis, and the vocal process which is formed in the posterior 2/5 part is also called intercartilaginous part of the rima glottalis. So, rima glottalis, it has two parts, intermembranous part and intercartilaginous part. Intermembranous part is present between the vocal fold. These are the vocal fold. And intercartilaginous part is present between the vocal process of the arytenoid cartilage. Now, laryngeal cavity. This laryngeal cavity from above downward, we divide into three parts or three subdivisions are there. First is the vestibule part. This vestibule is supraglottic part. This part, this lies above the vestibular fold. So, part of the laryngeal cavity above the vestibular fold is called as a vestibule. This one, this is the vestibule. It extends from eriepiglottic fold to the vestibular fold. Between the eriepiglottic fold and vestibular fold, this much part of the laryngeal cavity is the vestibule. And it shapes like funnel from above downward. Now, next part is sinus of the larynx. It is present between the two folds. This is vestibular fold and this is vocal fold. So, between vestibular fold and vocal fold, this space present, you can see this is the sinus of the larynx. Now, infraglottic part. The part of the larynx, laryngeal cavity, below the vocal fold is called infraglottic part. This is infraglottic part. So, this one, this is infraglottic part. This is truncated cone shape. And directed, truncated cone shape directed downward. So, in the laryngeal cavity, there are three parts or three subdivisions. First is the vestibule, which is present above the vestibular fold, between the epiglottic fold and the vestibular fold. Then there is a sinus of the larynx, which is present between the vestibular fold and the vocal fold. This one is the sinus of the larynx. And below the vocal fold, the space is called as an infraglottic part. Vocal fold, these are also called as a vocal cord. Vestibular fold, these are also called as a false vocal cord, and vocal fold, these are called as a true vocal cords. Now, sinus part of the larynx. This sinus, it is present between the sinus of larynx is present between the vestibular fold and the vocal fold. This one, it presents a deep mucous recess which extends between the vestibular fold and the vocal fold. It extends laterally towards the thyroid lamina. You can see here, extends laterally towards the thyroid lamina. And in this region, in the region of sinus of larynx, the quadrate membrane and precovocal membrane, they are absent. So, mucus lining, it bulges in this region. A mucus diverticulum is present, which opens in the anterior part of the sinus. This mucus diverticulum is called saccule of the larynx. The saccule of the larynx part, it contains mucus glands, and secretions of the mucus gland, it lubricates the renal glottis and vocal fold. In the vocal fold, the epithelium covering this vocal fold, it shows lining epithelium. Below the lining epithelium, submucosa is absent, so glands are not there in the epithelium covering this vocal fold. So, the lubrication of the rima glottidis in vocal fold is done by this mucus gland present in the saccule of the larynx. So, also called as oil cans of the larynx. Now, we have seen cartilages, membranes and ligaments of the larynx. Now, muscles of the larynx. Muscles of the larynx we divide into two parts. Extrinsic muscles and the intrinsic muscles of the larynx. Extrinsic muscles of the larynx are the muscle which attaches the larynx to the surrounding structure, and they move the larynx as a whole. These are suprahyoid as well as infrahyoid group muscles. Suprahyoid are elevators and infrahyoid, these are depressors. So suprahyoid muscles are the, here you can see, suprahyoid muscles are the digastric. Digastric muscle, stylohyoid muscle, then mylohyoid muscle and geniohyoid muscle. This is the mylohyoid, this is digastric, this one. So, stylohyoid, mylohyoid, geniohyoid and digastric, these are suprahyoid group of muscles. These are extrinsic muscles which help to, they act on larynx as well as hyoid bone, they help to elevate the larynx. Depressors of larynx, these are the intrahyoid group of muscles. These are sternothyoid, sternothyroid and omohyoid. Now, intrinsic muscles of the larynx. Intrinsic muscles of the larynx, these act on the laryngeal inlet. They help to close the laryngeal inlet. They also act on the cartilages and help to tense the vocal cord or vocal fold. Change the shape of the rima glottis. So, they have action on the vocal fold or vocal cord in the inlet of larynx. Intrinsic muscles are cricothyroid muscle, posterior cricoarytenoid muscle, lateral cricoarytenoid muscle, transverse arytenoid muscle, oblique arytenoid muscle, arypiglotticus, thyroepiglotticus, and the vocalis. So, in detail about this muscle, origin, insertion, nerve supply, action, we are going to study in the next part. Cricothyroid is an intrinsic muscle of larynx, but it is present on the outer aspect. This is the only muscle which is present on the outer aspect of the larynx.